Starting off this list in our number 10 spot, we have cows. Cows are one of the sweetest and cutest animals out there, and it totally makes sense why people call them grass puppies. The area around Chernobyl was known for its agriculture before the disaster, so of course that means there were definitely a lot of cows that could be found. Since farm animals are not only expensive, but can also be used as a source of income, many people took their farm animals with them, but many of these animals had already been exposed to the radiation in some capacity, and while it didn't affect them right away, the newer generations saw much more of the effects. In 1989, many farmers began reporting birth defects in their animals, some being much more severe than others. As time went on, the cows became less mutated, but that doesn't mean the effects went away. As the cows continued to graze on feed that was contaminated, the effects became more internal. This has led completely normal-looking cows near the exclusion zone to begin producing milk that is toxic and not fit for consumption. This is just one of the clear examples of how, even though the visible effects may have worn off, there are still lasting effects that we probably hadn't previously considered. In our number 9 spot today, we have barn swallows. Any animal who lives in the exclusion zone have been affected by the disaster, and that includes those who spend most of their time in the sky. I'm obviously talking about birds. The barn swallows in Chernobyl are one animal who have seen a change in their physical appearance that has lasted all of the years since the nuclear meltdown. It is unclear why these birds have been affected greater than their land animal counterparts, or if these changes will ever reverse to their previous state, but here's what they are currently dealing with. The swallows appear to have severely deformed beaks, disproportionate feathers, some had partial albinism, and they were seen to have much smaller brains. Of course, some of these issues are much worse than others, and I'm sure these changes have significantly affected their ways of life, but of course they continue to adapt as time goes on. It is sad that this human-made disaster has affected them in such a negative way, but the fact that they are still around really shows their adaptability and resilience. In our number 8 spot today, we have boars. Boars are often seen wandering around the exclusion zone, but they also make their way into the surrounding towns as well, which is creating quite a problem. Boars are a fairly common food source, and it's not unusual to come across one, but here's the problem if you live in the area. How are you supposed to tell which boars are radioactive and which aren't? Basically, you can't until it's too late. The boars who aren't radioactive might come across and intermingle with one who is, but they also like to eat mushrooms, and if they're searching for their food within the exclusion zone, it's a highly likely possibility that they'll find themselves eating a radioactive mushroom. This is posing quite a problem. In 2017, there was a study that found that approximately 1 out of every 3 boars that were killed in the nearby areas of Germany, which for the record isn't even that close to Chernobyl, have been found to be radioactive and super unsafe for human consumption. You'd think that being that far away would make you safe, but as we clearly now know, the effects of the disaster stretched far and wide. In our number 7 spot today, we have Przewalski's horse. These horses first originated in Mongolia and were wild horses that became endangered. They first became endangered due to hunters who would often kill the stallion, which of course would provide many difficulties in terms of reproduction. These horses weren't doing well in captivity, which made things even more difficult. This, combined with the harsh winters, which would often claim their lives, left things looking quite grim for the species. In the late 1990s, however, in an effort to help repopulate these animals, 30 of them were released into the Ukrainian side of the exclusion zone, and it is believed that some of these original horses are actually still alive today, which is amazing, but camera trap images have also shown young horses, which means that they are repopulating, which is a huge win. Their expanding population in such a harsh environment could mean that they might potentially be able to return from the brink and go on to continue as a species, which is something we always want to see. In our number 6 spot today, we have cats. In the rush of the evacuation, many pets were left behind in Chernobyl, and that of course includes cats. With little to do, and of course more kittens being born, this paved the way for a group of feral cats to take over the exclusion zone. These cats wander in and out of the zone and find all of their favorite snacks, such as radioactive rodents or the less common radioactive insects. These cats certainly have had quite a difficult time surviving, as they are a perfect tasty snack for much larger predators and are certainly not equipped to deal with the harsh winters, but even still, there is said to be at least 100 stray cats living in the exclusion zone. There are efforts underway to have the uncontaminated ones put up for adoption, but the difficulty is in testing them and also re-domesticating these animals who have had to fend for themselves for so long. In our number 5 spot today, we have dogs. Since we just talked about the cats who were sadly left behind, it's only fair we talk about the dogs too. It's strange that these two domesticated animals would have such different experiences after the disaster, but they absolutely have. There are far more dogs who have managed to survive throughout the years than cats, but that is most likely due to the fact that they aren't as easy to catch and eat as prey as cats are. But dogs have a whole other challenge, and that is they have a hard time hunting and feeding themselves. There are workers who continue to work the dangerous job at the plant, and they continually feed the dogs living in the zone, which is something that truthfully is so nice to hear. It is also said that there are dogs living in this area that have begun mating with wolves, which is only going to breed dogs that will be more likely to be able to survive on their own, which I suppose is a good thing. Similar to the cats, many of the stray dogs are being studied to see if they can be adopted into homes outside of the zone so that they don't have to continue living in these harsh environments that they really were not bred for. In our number 4 spot today, we have European gray wolves. One of the species of animals that has been thriving ever since the disastrous nuclear meltdown has been the European gray wolf. Due to the lack of humans in the Chernobyl exclusion zone, they have been able to thrive, and it has been said that the wolves in this area actually have a population that is 7 times higher than that of comparable sites. Researchers are still trying to figure out exactly why this is happening, but it has obviously shown them that despite the effects of radiation in humans, the radiation clearly isn't affecting the wildlife's ability to reproduce. So this seems like just a regular gray wolf, but here's where things get a little different. Just because the wolves seem to be doing fine doesn't mean they aren't radioactive. These wolves, since they're such a high population, are beginning to travel farther and spread out more, which creates quite a problem. Not that we're just going up and petting wolves, but if you did come in contact with one of these wolves, you'd be getting a high dose of radiation just by touching them. Touching a carcass of these wolves with bare hands is absolutely not recommended. So while it is absolutely incredible to see the wildlife doing so well in this zone, we are now faced with an entirely different issue that we haven't really ever had before. In our number 3 spot today, we have the Eurasian lynx. This one is on this list for a different reason than most. It isn't because of anything this animal is or isn't doing, but instead is due to the fact that this animal was once believed to have entirely disappeared from Europe. It was fairly recently in 2014 that researchers realized they had made a comeback in a big way. Similar to most of the animals we've talked about today, the Eurasian lynx has been able to thrive due to the lack of human population and interference. Their downfall was attributed to urbanization as well as hunters, and they were mostly wiped out in the early 20th century, although they remained in certain parts of Siberia. There is still a lot more research that needs to be done about these creatures to determine exactly how radioactive they are, and this will take time due to the dangers of the zone they reside in, as well as the nature of these creatures in general. But just being able to see that an animal that was struggling has been able to make such a comeback is probably one of the best things to come out of such a horrible disaster. In our number 2 spot today, we have bison. Bison are right up there with wolves for most dangerous radioactive animal, and that is due to their size, as well as the fact that they are a source of food for some. These huge animals can weigh up to 2,200 pounds and are certainly not an animal that is easily messed with. Many bison weren't affected by the radiation immediately, and instead it became much more of an issue once they started eating food that had been contaminated. They like to feed on grass, and a lot of it, and the radiation didn't only affect animal life, but plant life as well, making their food source a literal feeding ground for radioactive material. Similar to the wolves we talked about before, running into these guys isn't only a threat now because of their size, but now because if you get too close, you could be facing some unsafe levels of radiation. In our number 1 spot today, we have spiders. I've talked about my hatred for spiders a lot on this channel, but to be honest, they keep doing cool things, so I have to keep talking about them. Okay, well maybe this one is less cool and more scary, but still, they deserved a spot. Spiders that are residing within the exclusion zone are of course radioactive, but it's not only the spiders that are now dangerous to touch, but it is also their webs. Spiders in Chernobyl are literally making radioactive webs, which is the stuff straight out of a comic book. These radioactive webs are also being woven in much different ways than they were before, which would suggest some sort of genetic mutation at play. Spiders were already a creature I'd like to stay far, far away from, but radioactive spiders really adds a whole other level. Not only are the spiders now dangerous for non-radioactive animals to touch, but walking through their web is equally as dangerous to those who aren't thriving in the radiation. So not only do you have to watch out for the regular old radioactive material, but now also the never-ending construction of radioactive webs. Great.
Starting us off at number 10, we have the beautiful red fox. Since the devastating events of the Chernobyl explosion back in 1986, the exclusion zone has pretty much become a ghost town. But only for humans. As far as wildlife is concerned, this place is booming like Vegas on a Friday night. One of the most often seen animals there is the highly adaptable red fox. Red foxes are known to thrive in many different kinds of environments, from urban and rural areas, from Canada all the way to Australia, and Chernobyl is no exception. The red fox is not exactly accustomed to humans, especially near Chernobyl, so most of these foxes are not actually scared of the tourists that do explore the exclusion zone every year. Many visitors report that these foxes actually approach them hoping for a little treat. Now, how sweet is that? In a previous video, I don't hold back my fear of the piles of old dolls that also inhabit Chernobyl, but if I have the chance to get close to a red fox and maybe become best friends with it, I might just have to go. But what's actually weird about it? Well, there's nothing that will stick out more in a 35-year-old ghost town of one of the biggest radiation blasts ever than a beautiful red fox. The dolls make sense to me. The foxes, they need to relocate to like my backyard where I can feed them and love them forever because, crikey, I love wildlife. At number 9, we have elk. Back in 2018, tourists spotted this large creature in a water tank at Chernobyl. And no, it wasn't a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle. It was a poor, stranded, full-size elk. As far as its age and its ninja skills, that is unknown. This large and beautiful creature somehow fell into the water tanks between the 5th and the 6th reactors and was reportedly stuck in the radioactive water for 3 days. Tourists called the local fire department to come and help save the poor animal. One firefighter tethered a rope to its antlers so that while being towed by the boat back to safety, the animal could keep its head above water. The entire rescue took about an hour before the elk was brought up onto the bank, where it then rested for about 4 hours before finally making its way back to the forest for some much needed R&R. No one quite knows how it got in the tank, but many believe it was running away from wolves or some other type of predator and accidentally fell into the tank after. A local radiation expert, Dennis Vizhnevitsky, said the radiation dose it had would not be fatal. The elk will survive in spite of taking a big radiation dose. If you ask me, this sounds like the birth of a superhero, you know? Like the wolves chase the elk falls into a radioactive river, it re-submerges with radioactive superpowers, and then it seeks out its revenge on the wolves? Come on, it writes itself. Joking aside, bless the hearts of everyone involved saving that poor animal. But I would be on the lookout for a mutated elk out there, because after swimming in radioactive water for 3 days, dang, that's gotta do something. At number 8, we have the cousin of the radioactive elk, the radioactive deer. Back in 1986, during the Chernobyl blast, most of Western Russia and Europe was blanketed by a toxic cloud. That toxic cloud reached all the way out to Norway and impacted the wildlife there almost as much as it did in the Ukraine. In central and southern Norway, the migratory reindeer often feed on lichen and fungus, two foods of the reindeer that were exposed to large amounts of radiation from that toxic cloud. These reindeer now contain higher levels of radioactivity that are beyond the European Union limit for consumption, which is a huge problem for the indigenous people of the area, known as the Sami. The Sami heavily rely on the reindeer for being one of their best sources of food, and yet for the first time ever, they're being told it is not safe to eat some of these animals. Just days after the blast in 1986, the government tested the radiation in the reindeer and measured anywhere between 30,000 to 60,000 becquerel per kilogram. This forced authorities to raise the limit of acceptable radiation found in animals from 600 becquerel per kilogram to 3,000, so the Sami still had enough food sources to sustain them. Lavrent Skutrud, an environmental radiation expert of the Norway Radiation Protection Authority, says it is important to remember that the permissible levels are not toxic limits. The limits are instead intended to minimize the amount of radiated food people consume every year, generally trying to keep it below 80,000 a year. The levels of radiation have fallen over the years, and there are still spikes from time to time. While these reindeer were studied in Norway and not exactly Chernobyl, deer are abundant in the exclusion zone and are known to migrate far distances. So, from Chernobyl all the way to Norway, you can find large numbers of radioactive deer. That sounds weird. Coming in at number 7, we have brightly colored birds. That's right, bright colored little birds. Creepy, am I right? Now, okay, I know this one is a little vague, but let me tell you why it's specifically these birds. Professor Timothy Mousseau and Dr. Anders Moeller studied 1,570 birds in the forests and surrounding areas of Chernobyl. They found that the populations of birds that were colored red, orange, and yellow, such as the yellowhammer, have decreased more than those of larger and less vibrant colors. The reason being? Antioxidants and carotenoids. Birds that produce carotenoids have brighter colors. Producing those bright colors, laying large eggs, and migrating large distances uses up a large amount of antioxidants in the bird's body, making them more susceptible to higher levels of radiation and decreasing their populations. Among the species that were most impacted are orioles, blackbirds, blue-tailed quails, hoopoes, and robins. I was really hoping the radiation was the reason these birds were bright colored, and that maybe there was a tie-dye oriole out there or something, but I'm afraid I'm out of luck. Staying with the bird theme, coming in at number 6 is the white-tailed eagle. Unlike the small, colorful, radioactive birds, the endangered white-tailed eagle is thriving in the Ukraine. University of Georgia researchers completed a month-long camera study laying dead fish carcasses near the riverbeds of the exclusion zone to see what kinds and how many different predator species would come and feed off the dead fish. James Beasley of Savannah River Ecology Laboratory said, "We've seen evidence of a diversity of wildlife in the CEZ through our previous research, but this is the first time that we've seen white-tailed eagles, American mink, and river otter on our cameras." Imagine watching an endangered species come flocking back in large numbers to feed in only one area. Hey, maybe radioactive fish just tastes a bit better. As much as I love seafood though, I think I'm just gonna leave it for the eagles. Coming in at our halfway point, number 5, we have the European brown bear. Reported back in 2014 for the first time in 100 years, a brown bear was seen in the exclusion zone of Chernobyl. A Ukrainian collaborator for the Transfer Exposure Effects Research Program by the name of Sergei Gaschek set up cameras hoping to learn more about the effects of the radioactivity in the area when all of a sudden, one night on camera, a brown bear decided to make its big entrance back into Chernobyl. Brown bears are not the first large mammal to be seen in the exclusion zone, but it is definitely something to celebrate after a brown bear pieces out of there 100 years ago. Project leader Mike Woods from the University of Salford reported that, "We are basically working on the assumption that as you move people out of the equation and human pressure and disturbance is removed, then any animals that have a corridor into the exclusion zone find they are suddenly away from the pressures and dangers presented by people." So basically, this radioactive ghost town is a heaven on earth for all of our large furry friends. But hey, as long as you got the bare necessities, who cares what it looks like? I wonder if our buddy Bigfoot ever vacations there. At number 4, going down in size from the European brown bear, we have firebugs. Little radioactive bugs who spontaneously combust and fly around the Ukraine terrorizing people. It's mayhem! Just kidding. Sadly, it's not as cool as that. Sorry. Back in April of 2011, our good friends Anders Moeller and Timothy Mousseau were collecting flowers in the famous Red Forest to study their pollen when they came across these little firebugs. They collected a few hundred of these little bugs and compared the markings on bugs from places of higher radiation to those of places of lower radiation. The result? Firebugs from higher radiation spots tended to have missing or deformed markings on them, such as missing dots or eyes, as some others call them. There you have it. What happens when a bug becomes radioactive? It loses a spot. Wow. Starting us off in our top 3 is arguably the most intelligent mammal on Earth. Humans. That's right, we are technically animals, and you can find humans in the exclusion zone almost every day of the year. In one of my previous videos, I told you all that there are actual tours to the Chernobyl site, and around 12,000 tourists visit the site every year. That's 32.8767123 people a day, because that makes sense. From 2014 to 2018, Meredith Yeager, the team leader of the US National Cancer Institute, sequenced the genomes of 130 children that were conceived after the 1986 disaster. They looked at children born from 1987 to 2002, as well as the genomes of the children's parents, with at least one of the parents being exposed to and within 45 miles of the 1986 blast. While the tests proved that the children of Chernobyl survivors and witnesses didn't carry more genetic mutations, some of those originally exposed did develop thyroid cancers. Studies found that more radiation exposed and the younger the person was increased the chances of developing the cancer. But of course, nowadays radioactive levels are much lower and measurements are taken with a dosimeter every single day to verify the safety for human exploration. So, if you want to go to Chernobyl or already have been, please let me know what it was like down in the comments. Coming in at number 2 is a real weird one. A giant catfish. Seriously. Over in Chernobyl's cooling pond, giant catfish can be seen swimming and even the odd time caught by adventurous fishermen. Back in 2016, a video surfaced of the massive aquatic animal in Chernobyl's cooling pond, and sure enough, many people thought it to be some kind of mutated monster fish. But whether we wish it was or not, radiation is not the reason for its massive size. The Wells catfish is a species known to reach gargantuan size. Some of these fish can reach up to 800 pounds, but are extremely rare due to the fact that most of the time they are mistaken for beluga sturgeon, or just exaggerated. It is entirely possible for these creatures to reach up to 350 pounds though, and that is still a massive fish to me. Italian fisherman Dino Ferrari caught one back in May of 2016, and this thing looks crazy. In the cooling ponds of Chernobyl, there is no real competition or higher predators of this giant fish, so it has more than enough food available to keep them packing on those gains and stay well fed. I never thought I would say this, but I think I'm scared of a catfish. Finally, coming in at our number one spot is definitely the weirdest animal on there. It's the raccoon dog. These half raccoon, half dog looking animals are a topic of controversy with some authorities, arguing if it is a member of the dog family or a member of the raccoon family, or the much more scientific name for it, part of the procyonid family. Yeah, raccoon sounds better. These crazy interesting animals are native to Eastern Asia as well as quite common in the exclusion zone of Chernobyl. Once again, this is not a really cool radioactive combination of a raccoon and a dog, but just another animal that isn't exactly sure which family it is a part of. In a study completed by the ecologist James Beasley, it was discovered that raccoon dogs were just one of the many species of mammals that are thriving in the exclusion zone. He even got his picture taken with one, and I gotta say, it's so fluffy! For the longest time, I really wanted to get a dog, and I didn't care what breed it was, but now, I think I want a raccoon dog.
Coming in at number 10, we have the fang-headed mountain lion. In November 2016, images of a dead mountain lion with fangs and whiskers growing out of the back of its head surfaced online. Sadly, this lion was killed by a hunter in southeastern Idaho, which I guess you know how I feel about that kind of thing. Anyway, an image of the lion was sent to the Idaho Fish and Game Southeast Regional Office. Now, this was in Pocatello. Am I saying that right? Let me know. These guys were not able to identify the deformity. Reportedly, they were baffled. Biologist Zach Lockyer said, "It's a bizarre situation and a bizarre photo. I'm honestly sad that a hunter killed this animal, but at the same time, a double-fanged lion? Terrifying." Coming into number 9, we have glow-in-the-dark cats. It may sound like science fiction, but it isn't. In 2011, scientists generated mutant glow-in-the-dark cats. I like cats, but I've read repeatedly, and I may add that cats officially meet the definition of psychopaths. I've read that if they were any bigger than they currently are, they would kill you. So, not so cute now. I'm not sure if cats glowing in the dark makes things any better. I have to say, if I saw one, I would be terrified or assume that I was drunk. Scientists genetically modified the cats, inserting one gene into them, a version of a green fluorescent protein that light up crystal jellyfish. Why? Well, actually, there's a really, really good reason. Apparently, it helps them resist feline AIDS, which I've just discovered is a thing. The GFP protein is found in jellyfish, and scientists use it in cats to make it easy to spot the altered genes and help scientists study HIV. So, scary as it may be, it's actually a really, really good thing. Glow in the dark cats, though, I don't know. I need your opinion on this. Let me know in the comment section down below. Ah ha ha, I don't like this at number 8. We have the three-eyed snake. Forget the three-eyed raven. This three-eyed snake is here and spreading fear in the Australian outback. Nicknamed Monty Python for the lols, I would not be laughing if I met this beast. Pythons scare me at the best of times, but pythons with three eyes? Boy, bye. This snake was found on a highway in, legitimately, the remote Australian town of Humpty Doo, which actually is the best town name that I have ever heard ever, and I would deeply consider moving there if it weren't for the three-eyed snakes. Bummer. At the time, Monty, no, the cute name does not help. At the time Monty was discovered in March 2018, he was thought to be a baby and measured just half a meter. I say just, that's half a meter more snake than I can deal with. Now, well, I bet that he's bigger. It is thought that the reason for the deformity is, delightfully, a twin absorbed by Monty in the womb. Blah, snake womb. No! This discovery was made by Northern Territory Parks and Wildlife Rangers, so unfortunately it is definitely legit. Suffice to say, he sees you. There's always time for a dad joke, and don't even at me. So it seems that this isn't a one-time only thing. Coming in at number 7, we have a two-headed shark. Shout out to my friend Mingles, who absolutely loves a shark. Like, babe, how do you feel about a two-header? I need to know. It seems in 2016, the Beeb reported that a two-headed shark embryo had been found, which, well, I mean, a two-headed shark sounds like the plot for Sharknado 7 or Jaws 2027. Two heads! Honestly horrifying. Scarily, shortly after that story broke, National Geographic, something I consider a trusted news source, published an article declaring that actually, they have been turning up worldwide, which is pretty freaking terrifying, am I right? It seems that blue sharks are most likely to have a mutant baby because they carry so many babies at a time. Double-headed sharks! I will see you a two-headed shark and raise you a two-headed alligator. I need both hands to do this, so. That's right, number 6, two-headed alligators! Holy moly, I cannot deal with a one-headed alligator, let alone two. This is much worse than a two-headed shark in my opinion, because I feel like alligators are more prominent in our human living areas than sharks are. Like with sharks, I mean, we're kind of in their territory when we're in the ocean, right? But alligators, kind of have to share. In 2014, a two-headed gator was allegedly spotted in Tampa in Florida. It was spotted by a man named Justin Arnold, who posted the images to social media, after which they were shared thousands of times by freaked out people. On Facebook, Arnold said that the gator had been reported by several people to the Florida Fish and Wildlife Conservation Commission. A lot of people were dubious as to the authenticity, calling the image a hoax. I honestly really hope it is. The next animal is an urban legend rather than a fact, but if it is real, well, that's terrifying. Coming into number 5, we have the meat slabs. In early 2000s, rumors started flying around the internet that McDonald's meat was made from genetically modified cow mutants, grown specifically to be burger food in a secret lab somewhere. The original source seems to be from a fake email uncovered in Brazil. The email said that the people who had seen the creatures reared in the lab were absolutely horrified, as like you obviously would be, right? They said that the mutants had no limbs, bones, horns, or fur, that their heads were the size of a baseball, and that they were fed through tubes directly to the stomach. Meat slabs. Grim. The email also stated that those who eat this meat are at the risk of catching a disease akin to AIDS and Alzheimer's. What on earth? Honestly, that's when they lost me. Like, eat this meat and you'll get AIDS? I don't agree. I think this is fake. Still though, scary. Coming into number 4, we have the leaf rat. A farmer in the Ratlam district of India found a rat with a soybean plant growing out of its body on his land, which I imagine was a sight to behold. Farmer Datar Singh said that his neighbors filmed the mutant rat. Now, the footage is pretty shocking and really sad, because the rat seems to be struggling with its deformity. That's just a warning for you before I show you the footage. The plant growing in its back is really big, and the rat is probably in a whole lot of pain. That pain is only going to continue to increase as the plant grows. So I guess you're wondering, how did this happen, right? The best explanation is that a soybean seed must have fallen into an open wound in the rat's body, and it then found the right conditions to grow. Horrifying. As the plant grew, it meant that the wound in the rat was unable to heal, leaving it constantly exposed, which makes me feel sick and sad at the very same time. Ooh. Coming into number 3, we have the Fukushima fish. The Fukushima power plant accident took place in May 2011, during which a nuclear power plant spilled radioactive material into the North Pacific Ocean. Fast forward 4 years, and this beast was pulled out of the water near where the disaster took place. If that isn't a mutant fish, honestly, I don't know what it is. Honey looks prehistoric to me. Honestly, I just made that up. I feel like that might be my new favorite insult. Like, lol, you look prehistoric. I'm actually honestly not mean enough to say that to anyone, but I can think it, maybe. No. It's too mean to even think, but a good insult that you can have for free. Anyway, Japanese fisherman Hirosaka Hiroshi tweeted an image of himself with the fish, which he explained to be a massive wolf fish double its size. Coming into number 2, we have the beast. Have a look at this image and tell me what on earth you think this creature is. Or, I don't know. Is that claws? Cloven hooves? I'll give you a second to make up your mind. Done it? Good? So it seems that this poor creature was a lamb, and it was promptly and creatively dubbed the Devil Lamb after it was born. The story goes that in 2017, in a South African village, inhabitants were shocked and disturbed by the birth of a human-looking lamb. Villagers were convinced that either bestiality or witchcraft were at play when the human-looking lamb was birthed, although sadly the creature was stillborn. DNA samples confirmed that the creature was indeed a lamb, even though other people had other theories. Many locals were convinced that the dead sheep was the work of the devil and a bad omen of things to come. Devil. Finally, coming into number 1, we have the animals of Chernobyl. This is actually so sad. Following the infamous Chernobyl disaster of 1986, a lot of animals were born with serious mutations. Chernobyl and the towns of Pripyat are still exclusion zones, meaning you can't go there, but obviously it's pretty hard to stop wild animals roaming. In the immediate fallout, farm animals produced seriously deformed offspring, such as this cow. Here is a lamb also reportedly from Chernobyl. Concerningly, there is now talk that Chernobyl wild wolves could be spreading mutations across Europe, which is, you know, worrying. to say the least.
Starting off in our number 10 spot, we have Chernobyl ghosts. While you can visit certain parts of Chernobyl today that have been deemed safe, taking a trip may not be for everyone, or perhaps it's too far, or whatever 100 reasons there are for not wanting to visit the site. But with the technology we have now, there's another way you can visit the site, and that is through trusty old Google Maps. Many internet people have walked through the streets of the exclusion zone searching around, seeing what photos Google Maps holds, but with those virtual tours comes something that is absolutely terrifying people, and that is the apparent sighting of what is referred to as the ghosts of Chernobyl. Many people have reported seeing shadowy figures and sometimes even faces in the abandoned buildings left in the exclusion zone, and I have to admit, some of the screenshots I've seen are pretty terrifying. Do you believe that these are real ghosts caught on camera, or is it just a legend like many of the other things that we have on today's list? In our number 9 spot today, we have animal mutations. There's no doubt that the Chernobyl nuclear disaster had devastating effects on all of the life in the area surrounding this meltdown. I think that's something most of us can agree on, and while most of the human life has moved out of the area, there is a lot of wildlife that remains, and those animals have taken over the exclusion zone. While scientists often observe and test these animals, it is clear that they are all contaminated in radiation and thus have mutated in certain ways. But despite the rumors, there are in fact no three-headed cows wandering around. I think this might be one of the most popular legends floating around in terms of the Chernobyl disaster, the story that there are just full-on monsters living within the exclusion zone, or that the meltdown happened because of a failed radiation experiment on these animals. There are tons of swirling rumors regarding the animals, but in the end, the effects of the radiation is seen much more in things like their ability to reproduce, or them not being fit for consumption, rather than in things like extra limbs and heads and eyes. In our number 8 spot today, we have the government cover-up part 1. Of course, a disaster like this is going to get some government conspiracies swirling around, and we've got a few of them to talk about today, so let's start off now with the first one. This little ditty suggests that the Chernobyl disaster was actually conducted by the Soviet government due to the failure of a new, at the time, huge missile defense radio structure called Duga 3. This structure, that actually exists in real life, is suspected of having been wildly over budget, and it was the source of many, many complaints after it was built. The systems were extremely powerful and broadcast in shortwave radio bands. They would appear without warning and sounded like a sharp, repetitive tapping noise, and they would disrupt things like legitimate broadcasts, amateur radio, commercial aviation communications, and utility transmissions, which all led to there being international complaints. And at the time, people didn't know what this structure was or what the sound was. This led people to think that the signal was actually being used for things such as Soviet mind control or weather control experiments. So this story suggests that in order to eliminate it, the nearby Chernobyl facility was allowed to go into meltdown. It seems like they probably could have done something much less lethal and much less damaging, so I'm not exactly sure how true this one could possibly be, but I do suppose that this is a list of urban legends. In our number 7 spot today, we have the Chernobyl zombies. This little legend can most likely be attributed to a video game that takes place in the exclusion zone, but it is certainly not based on any real-life facts, at least that we all know of. This little legend claims that after the Chernobyl disaster, we of course know that unfortunately people lost their lives, but what happens if those who did then became the undead? Yep, we're obviously talking about zombies here. There are plenty of legends that suggest the exclusion zone isn't dangerous and off limits because of toxic radiation, but actually because there are brain-eating zombies wandering the area. I mean, I personally have never received a lethal dose of radiation, so I cannot confirm or deny that this would turn one into a zombie, but I'm just gonna go ahead and call this one out for being fake. I mean, at least I'm really, really, really hoping it is. We've dealt with enough in the last year and a half. We really don't need to add radiation zombies onto the list. In our number 6 spot today, we have It Never Happened. Okay, this is probably the easiest one to disprove, but perhaps it's not. This legend suggests that the whole disaster never actually happened and that the entire thing is just conspiracy. I don't know why anyone would do that, but hey, this is just a legend after all. There would be so many hoops to have to jump through in order to pull off that level of a stunt and keep it up for this long. Like, let's be honest, there are too many people involved for all of them to have been able to all keep the secret for this long. There's just no way everyone could keep their mouths shut. And what about the people who passed away from the event? I just have a lot of questions about this one. There are some weird legends on this list, but I do have to say that this one might be the least believable. And we just talked about zombies. Unfortunately, it seems as though the Chernobyl nuclear disaster was a very real thing that happened, and it affected a ton of people. It was certainly an event that changed the world and made us all a lot smarter when it comes to nuclear safety, I hope. In our number 5 spot today, we have this super secret laboratory. This legend suggests that the Chernobyl disaster was a planned event that took place for a specific reason. You may be wondering what this apparent plan is, and that would be the plan to build a super secret laboratory. I mean, think about it. You want to build a super secret place, just cause the entire place to be so terribly contaminated in radiation that no one will want to search the area. Or those who do might even meet an untimely fate. It certainly is an evil plan, but it could potentially be quite effective. I don't think that this is the case at all, and I don't think Chernobyl was a planned event in order to build a secret lab, but I do agree that whoever originated this legend has quite an imagination. What do you think this lab would contain if this were true? Like an Area 51 type thing? Aliens and mermaids? Or perhaps that's where they're hiding all the three-eyed animals everyone keeps talking about? In our number 4 spot today, we have the Chernobyl illness. This is one of the more malicious stories on this list, which I do not like at all. People who lived in the region of the disaster had a huge impact on their day-to-day lives, and a lot of people had long-lasting health impacts from the entire thing. This disaster has been linked to terrible things like an increase in thyroid cancer, as well as other forms of cancer. So when fake stories of a fake disease began circulating around, it was honestly super messed up. One of these fake illnesses coincided with the height of panic, misinformation, and ignorance surrounding HIV, and thus the totally made-up condition of Chernobyl HIV was born. This made-up disease was the source of many a whispered warning against friendship or relationships with those who had survived the disaster. Like, these people just survived the worst nuclear accident in history and now they have to worry about harmful schoolyard gossip? Yeah, no thanks. Despite its terrible origins, people still spread rumors and fear-mongered, and it truly is a cruel, cruel, entirely made-up story. In our number 3 spot today, we have Government Cover-Up Part 2. After the release of the incredible HBO show Chernobyl, which you haven't seen it, it is a must-watch. Like, it is such a good show. I watched it with Che, if you remember that guy, and it was just unreal. Anyway, after the show's release, the Russian government released a statement saying that the show was actually anti-Soviet Union propaganda, and that they would be releasing their own Chernobyl show, which would detail how the CIA was actually the cause for the disaster. Rumor has it that the CIA sabotaged something which caused the reactor to melt down, and the whole thing was actually America's fault. I have no way of either proving or disproving this theory or legend, but I think it's probably safe to say that someone here isn't telling the truth. And it's not like it's a new thing that Russia and the US aren't exactly getting along. Maybe it's all just propaganda, or maybe there's some truth? I don't know. What do you guys think? In our number 2 spot today, we have the Blackbird. People in the district of the Ukraine that houses Chernobyl have told stories of sightings of the Blackbird for years, and it is perhaps the most well-known legend that comes from the area. The Blackbird is a human creature with wings and piercing red eyes, and it was apparently seen by workers at the Chernobyl plant on the fateful day of the nuclear disaster. After this, it was reported that anyone who had seen the bird would later report suffering from terrible nightmares and begin receiving threatening phone calls. Many of the people where the legend originates from unfortunately were at the center of the disaster and have since passed away from radiation poisoning, so no one is sure if the Blackbird really is out there or not. The Blackbird is said to be a symbol of something terrible being afoot, so seeing it is definitely not a great thing to happen to a person. I think it's probably just another one to add to the list of reasons why maybe a Chernobyl visit isn't the best idea. In our number 1 spot today, we have alien cleanup. There's always got to be an alien story to keep things interesting and to add to the list of questions we have for extraterrestrials when we hopefully eventually find them, and Chernobyl is no different. Rather than the aliens causing the disaster, which might be where your mind went, instead this legend suggests that they helped in the aftermath. Apparently some people out there think that the Chernobyl disaster wasn't as bad as it should have been. I don't think they mean it in as bad of a way as that sounds, but rather they are just surprised that the amount of people who passed away in the disaster wasn't higher, considering how bad the whole ordeal actually was. This, coupled with an apparent eyewitness account from a man named Mikhail Veritsky, who claimed he saw a fiery ball of light hovering for a few minutes above the exposed reactor on the night of the incident, has led people to speculate that maybe our friendly alien neighbors swooped down in the nick of time to help clean up the mess that was made. Apparently, this ball of light was also seen on September 16th, 1989, when there was more radiation leaking from the unit at Chernobyl, which some claim was the aliens containing the radiation. Honestly, I'd like to think that this one is true, because what a nice thing for the aliens to do. They probably have their own nuclear weapons, so they certainly didn't need ours, and we didn't really have the tools to clean it up, so I can definitely appreciate the fact that they lended a helping hand.
Starting us off at number 10 is an abandoned carnival. Now, I have always known carnivals to be very upbeat and happy places, but I think it's safe to say after toxic radiation, they ain't so fun. Just a mile and a quarter away from the Chernobyl power plant is the small town of Pripyat. Pripyat was the town where most workers at Chernobyl lived and raised their families prior to the famous blast. Obviously, that is not the case anymore. What is now left of this once popular carnival is a decaying Ferris wheel, bumper cars surrounded by overgrown vines, and an old rusty skeleton of a merry-go-round. It is said that the amusement park was set to open on May 1st, just 5 days after the Chernobyl incident occurred, but the people of Pripyat needed something to do while the reactor was melting down, so the town opened up the amusement park on April 27th. How charming. Nothing more sweet and fun than you and your family enjoying a beautiful Ferris wheel ride that sweeps in and out of toxic radiation. Ah, it's the little things in life.
In our ninth spot today, we have the ghosts. A number of people lost their lives over this terrible disaster, and it's believed that their souls are still around, haunting Pripyat. This one story in particular will give you the chills. It was told by nuclear physicist Andrei Karsukov. He visited the area in 1997 and claims he encountered a ghost. So when he arrived, he went to the power station and went to the number 4 reactor. That's where the explosion occurred. Now, he was there taking radiation readings when all of a sudden he heard someone screaming for rescue from a fire coming from inside. He said that it was impossible for someone to be inside of the old reactor room. For starters, the door requires a password and a handprint. And not only that, it would have tripped an alarm if someone managed to get inside. Yet, the screaming was clearly coming from inside. It sounded like someone was desperately trying to escape. So, he might have heard the ghostly cries from someone who lost their life in the power plant explosion. Isn't that scary? I think so.
Number 8, silhouettes of missing townspeople. Before I go any further on this one, let me just say that these silhouettes are not actually of real people left after the blast. A couple of sneaky and daring graffiti artists said to be from Germany and Belarus snuck into the radiation zone and thought it would be a good idea to spray paint silhouettes of people who once lived in this beautiful little community. So, these pieces more or less resemble what once was rather than resembling actual humans from the town. That being said, there are some unique silhouettes through the radiation zone, such as a little girl with pigtails reaching for a light switch in a random abandoned room. Somewhere outside, a boy pulling a truck towards a corner of the building, as well as silhouettes of random people dancing, and to finish it off, a small group of children jumping together in terror of the blast. Pretty morbid, if you ask me. Whether these silhouettes are based on specific real people or not, these random silhouettes are definitely a haunting thing to see, and I don't want to see them.
Coming in at number 7, we have the Bloody Red. The Bloody Red, or the Red Forest, is the name given to the forest area around Chernobyl. Why is it called that? Well, this area received a lot of radiation fallout. As a result, the trees turned this bright orange color and then died. Nowadays, not a single tree can grow there anymore. In fact, this area is considered the most radioactive land area on the planet. Yes, on the planet. Obviously, as a result, the 400 hectares of land are off limits. It's strictly prohibited to go in there. I mean, duh, unless you have a death wish and want to die from exposure to radiation. What's also scary is that in 2015, a fire broke out in the forest, and even more radioactive material was released from this burning. So yeah, that forest is a big no-go zone. Also, could they have given it a creepier name, like the Bloody Red? Really? Really?
Coming in at number 6 are piles of creepy dolls. Creepy dolls! I have seen plenty of horror films in my time, and nothing creeps me out more than a creepy, probably possessed, old doll. All through Pripyat, piles of dolls and doll heads can be seen in the randomest of places. Everywhere from windowsills, piles of debris, bed frames, tree branches, literally everywhere. Now, some of these dolls may be left over from the blast, but odds are they are all placed there by cheeky horror fans wanting to place their own touch on the Chernobyl site. Some of these are even propped up in specific poses with gas masks on. Annabelle, if you're watching this, you stay in your glass box. You got that?
We're now at our fifth and halfway mark with the Hospital of Death. This is said to be the deadliest hospital on the planet. So after the nuclear disaster, this hospital began quickly filling up with a number of sick and injured citizens. Nowadays though, obviously the hospital is abandoned. But the basement of the hospital contains a dark secret. In the basement, there are piles of first responders' clothing. These clothings belong to the first responders like the firemen, who were on the scene immediately after the explosion. Obviously, the clothing they wore when they rushed into the building is now highly contaminated, and still to this day emit dangerously high levels of radiation. So they were just dumped in the basement because they didn't know where else to get rid of it. In fact, the radiation in this building is 4,000 times higher than normal. It's crazy.
Number 4, radiation-eating fungus. In the words of Jeff Goldblum, life finds a way. Currently, there is a fungus growing inside the damaged fourth reactor of Chernobyl, where radiation levels are still insanely high. Discovered by scientists back in 2002, this fungus, when tested, showed that when exposed to higher ionizing radiation, it would actually grow faster. What happened to the tested fungus after? Who knows? Either way, I do wish I could have been there to test it with the other scientists, because I hear they were some pretty fun guys. I'll show myself out.
In our third spot today, we have the mutated animals. The Chernobyl nuclear disaster had devastating, lasting effects. The nuclear material leaked into the soil, contaminating food and water. In fact, the radioactive materials leaked into pastures and was eaten by cows, and then was later found in their milk that children were drinking. But let's talk more about these farm animals that were affected. There were tons of weird mutated animals born near the disaster zone after this incident. Pigs, goats, and horses were born with messed up faces and extra limbs, or were just weird colors. Nowadays, there's a lot of stray dogs that roam the area. Sadly, because of their exposure to the radiation, they don't live a long life, and they may have a number of health issues.
Coming in at number 2 is quite possibly the strangest but most obvious thing you will find in all of Chernobyl. Tourists! Apparently, around 12,000 tourists visit the exclusion zone every single year. One tourism company promises 11 hours of excitement with a respirator and a dosimeter included. There are even some nearby hotels that request you leave your radioactive shoes outside and don't bring them into the hotel with you once you return. No matter how safe or unsafe you think it is to visit the exclusion zone, quite obviously thousands of people from around the world go and visit every single year. Honestly, it does seem kind of cool, and I'm sure there's a gift shop somewhere that sells shirts that say, "I went all the way to Chernobyl and all I got was this shirt and an extra thumb." I'd buy that. Hey, Lizzie, you want to go to Chernobyl with me?
No.
Okay.
And in our number 1 spot today, we have the Stalkers. This is absolutely insane. I don't think you guys are ready for this one. But the Stalkers is the name given to a group of Russians and Ukrainians that romanticize the apocalyptic environment of Pripyat. They sneak into abandoned buildings and explore them. Sometimes they even sleep over there. Also, to make matters weirder, they bring a gauger counter to see how much radiation they were exposed to on their journeys. Not only that, but apparently they also like to eat the fruit that grows in the danger zone. Like, this is their definition of fun, and they just love it. I highly, highly, highly recommend you don't do this, you know, for a number of obvious reasons. But like I said, the Stalkers love this. Starting off this countdown, we have the sarcophagus. Basically, this is a massive steel and concrete structure that covers the Chernobyl power plant. It was designed to help contain the radiation. The construction of the structure lasted for 206 days, and those working on it had to work in shifts of no more than 7 minutes. Any more time spent near the reactors would have killed them. But still, they did sacrifice their lives building this because thousands of workers still died from exposure to the radiation. Those that survived got severely ill, and majority of them developed cancer. Nowadays, the sarcophagus is still there, but it's beginning to crumble. In 2019, they were in the process of dismantling it because it was going to collapse. So a new one is currently being installed. That's probably the scariest thing in Chernobyl because of how deadly the building it's containing is. Coming in at number 9, we have the gas masks. And if you guys are liking this video or want to see part 3, then smash that like button. Chernobyl already looks like the place where an apocalypse occurred. Buildings are completely abandoned, run down, and overgrown with nature. What doesn't help is the piles upon piles of gas masks scattered all throughout Chernobyl. This really adds to the eeriness of this place. And again, makes it look like a place where a zombie or alien takeover occurred. In fact, there is one room inside a school which is just completely filled with child-sized gas masks. It's very creepy, but also sad. Like, imagine how frightened the young children were when this happened. The gas masks found there are just a sad reminder of the horrors that took place there when the reactor exploded. Moving on to number 8, we have the rotting toys. Littered all throughout the city are toys or personal belongings people had to leave behind. The saddest thing to see are pictures of children's toys left behind. Like, I just think that was probably someone's favorite little dolly. Go anywhere there and you'll find items scattered everywhere, now broken and covered in filth. Like, imagine, you're rushed out of your home and have to leave behind all your personal belongings. That must have been so hard. I can't imagine how everyone must have felt. It's really depressing to think about. Moving on at number 7, we have the examination chair. So this one is pretty strange, but somehow a gynecologist's examination chair ended up in the middle of the woods outside of a hospital. Not only is that super weird, but it's also super creepy. It's all rusted and beat up and looks like an old torture device. Not only that, but that means someone had to go inside the abandoned hospital, find that chair, and then carry it all the way back down and into the woods. I got a lot of questions. Why would someone do this? And how long did it take them to do this? And again, why would someone do this? Either way, it makes for a very spooky encounter. Moving on at number 6, we have the abandoned cooling tower. A partially constructed cooling tower can be found at the Chernobyl nuclear power plant. They were built to evaporate the cooling water from the 2 new reactors. Sadly, they were never completed. Now, these things are massive. The diameter was over 120 meters and it stands at 150 meters tall. Obviously, after the accident, there was no need to continue on with the construction of this, so the government just left the towers there along with everything else. Eventually, over time, nature will have its way with it and it will start to erode and crumble. It's just crazy seeing all these abandoned infrastructures. Imagine how life would have been if that explosion never happened. We're now at our 5th and halfway mark with the toxic river. There's a river that's just filled with radioactive water right near the reactor. Scariest part is, despite how toxic the water is, a bunch of aquatic life live there. In particular, giant catfish. Yes, giant catfish. A video from 2016 shows a massive catfish swimming in the water. People originally were like, oh my god, what the heck is that? It must be some sort of mutated animal. Later, it was just found out to be a giant catfish. But still, what the heck? And it's the fact that they have adapted to be able to survive in that highly toxic water. Like, that just baffles me. Not only that, but they can thrive there because the water has no higher predators. Obviously though, you're not allowed to go fishing there. Okay, I feel like that's a given, but I also feel like people would still try it, so I'm just gonna say it. Don't go fishing there. In our 4th spot, we have the jarfish. Speaking of fish, we're gonna go with this. So back in 2016, photographer and journalist Miriam Wazer took a trip to explore the ruins of Chernobyl. While inside an abandoned building, she came across something very creepy and odd. She found a bunch of fish and other specimen in jars. Why someone was collecting fish, it just baffles many. And they weren't even like proper beakers or science mason jars. No, no, it looked like someone emptied out their jar of pickles and then used it to store the specimen. I think it's best if those remain untouched. Like, can you imagine how stinky they would be if they were open nowadays? They would reek. Old stinky fish is not something I would ever want to handle. Now, the other specimen beside the fish are unknown. No one knows what the heck they are. But if you know, let me know in the comments below. Coming in at number 3, we have the abandoned hospitals. The hospitals at Chernobyl are quite eerie. They're just filled with rusted, empty hospital beds, littered syringes, and more. The walls and floors are cracking, and there's dirt and questionable red marks on the floor. I think the saddest thing, though, is that these hospitals are often trashed, with medical supplies just tossed everywhere. The days after the explosion happened, people were frantically rushing to hospitals. Hospital staff were overwhelmed by the amount of people there. This moment is still preserved in the hospitals to this day. It's pretty dark once you think about it. And at number 2 today, we have the Sad Alley. The Sad Alley, or the Alley of Memory, is an alley in the Ukraine created in memory of the villages and residents who had to flee from their homes during the disaster. Basically, it's a walkway with signs lining the sides. These signs are names of cities and villages that had to evacuate and leave everything behind. It's a way to ensure we just never forget the impact that this disaster had. It's really sad. And in our number 1 spot today, we have the radioactive spiders. Yes, you heard me correctly. Imagine if Peter Parker got bit by one of these bad guys. He'd be like a weirdly mutated Spider-Man or something like that. But anyways, the spiders in the exclusion zone are radioactive. So you definitely don't want to be bit by one. Oh wait, it gets worse. They also make radioactive webs. Yeah, you heard me, that's a thing. So you don't have to just worry about these spiders, but you have to worry about walking through their deadly webs. Like, what the heck? No thank you, nah. I'm not a fan of spiders, but imagine radioactive ones. That sounds like it belongs in a horror movie. Radioactive, radioactive.